بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبا القاسم محمد. طب القلوب ودوائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها، وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الصادقين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يقول الله في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله تواب رحيم. The first of our last salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. With your loudest voices in honor of Imam Sahib al-Asr al-Zaman. Respected scholars, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The discussion of ghiba, namima and buhtan, or backbiting, telling tales and false accusation, is a discussion that requires an in-depth analysis in order that we are able to cover three of the worst spiritual diseases that face the human being, and indeed three spiritual diseases that face many communities today and are a cause of the destruction of many communities today, and indeed the disunity between many of our communities today. That we find many of our people in our communities today coming forward and stating that the backbiting has brought about a lack of confidence not only in themselves but in the people around them. And the false accusation and the telling of tales does not bring harmony within a community. Rather, backbiting and false accusation and telling tales actually brings disunity within a community. And therefore you find that the lives of many people have been destroyed because of false accusation or because of people revealing acts of theirs which they wanted concealed. And indeed, a community which has backbiters and a community which has people who falsely accuse others or people who spread scandals is a community that is one open for destruction. For indeed, we find around the Islamic world today that there are many who have left the communities because of the false accusations people have put alongside their name, or the scandals that have been put alongside their name, or stories which have been revealed which they had wanted to be closed, files which had been opened which they had never wanted a reminder of. And therefore you find that backbiting, false accusation, rather than bringing optimism in a community, brings pessimism. For a person fears who they speak to, a person fears who they discuss their affairs with, because there is a fear that these affairs may one day come back and haunt them. And that's why a Muslim community, which is a strong one, is one which is made up of people who have trust between each other, rather than people who continuously backbite each other. And therefore one notices around the world today that there is a need for the brothers to work with each other and the sisters to work with each other in removing backbiting within a community. For we notice that backbiting is not only a person who backbites you, but that the listener to backbiting is part of the backbiting themselves. As our fourth Imam, on one occasion a person came to him and said to him that someone has been speaking behind your back and has said the following. The fourth Imam said to him, you are part of the crime. The person said to him, why? He said, because that person spoke and you made sure that the arrow reached me. That person shot the arrow. You made sure that the arrow came towards my direction. Therefore, when we examine these areas, the examination allows us to hopefully purify many of our communities which are besieged by people who backbite and people who falsely accuse each other of crimes which have not even been committed. And therefore, when we look at this area, the first area that has to be examined is the power of the tongue of the human being. For the tongue of the human being is one of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. if used properly. But if not used properly, it can be one of the most destructive weapons in the human being. That's why you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when discussing the tongue of the human being, there is an interesting anecdote in relation to the life of Luqman, where we find in the life of Luqman that one day his master had said to him, "O Luqman, go and sacrifice a sheep for me and bring me the two best parts of the sheep." And so Luqman went, and when he sacrificed the sheep, he brought the heart and the tongue back to his master. A few weeks later, his master said to him again, "Luqman, go and sacrifice for me a sheep and bring me the worst parts of the sheep." And so again, he went to sacrifice the sheep and he brought back the heart and the tongue. So the master said to him, "When I asked you to bring me back the best parts of the sheep, you brought me back the heart and the tongue. And when I asked you to bring me back the worst parts of the sheep, you brought me the heart and the tongue." Luqman replied, "Because the best parts of the creations of Allah, when purified, are the heart and the tongue of the human being. Whereas the worst parts of the creation of Allah, when left alone, are the hearts of and the tongues of the human being." That's why you find with all of us that our tongue is a blessing if used effectively. But when the tongue is let loose, it can destroy your community. Hence you notice in the Quran, Surah 30, verse 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ. But amongst the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what? Are the creations of the heavens and the earth. That the heavens have their seven bodies and the earth have their seven layers. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states that amongst my signs is the differences in your colors and the differences in your tongues. Meaning what? Meaning the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, amongst the signs in the human being, is the expression of language. Because language is one of the beauties of the tongue of the human being. But you go around the world today and you find that every human being expresses a different language in what is now a very small world. Furthermore, you find Nabi Musa talking about the power of the tongue of the human being when he states in the Quran, "Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassirli amri وَحْلَلْ عُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي." Nabi Musa states, "Ya Allah, loosen the knot from my tongue." Why? Because we recognize that for us to be eloquent, when we come to bring a message, our tongue has to be an eloquent one. That you find that, for example, people in many different professions today are required to make presentations or make seminars. And therefore it is vital for us in presentations that our tongue is one which is eloquent, rather than our tongue is one which is loosened not by a knot. We find here therefore that when one examines the tongue of the human being, its expression again is mentioned in the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Lisan. Ar-Rahman, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then say? Allama Quran, خلق الإنسان, علمه البيان. علمه البيان means what? Means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught mankind the beauty of expression and the beauty of speech. That's why Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullah wa salam, he talks about the tongue and he has a beautiful expression about the tongue. He says, جرمه صغير وجرمه ثقيل. He says, the tongue of the human being, its weight is so light, but its devastation is so powerful. And the idea that when you come to weigh the tongue of the human being, you find that the tongue weighs something very little, puts it on scales, and you'll find it weighing something so little. Yet when you allow that tongue to be loose, it can destroy a whole nation. It can destroy a community. It can destroy the life of a human being. But you bring me the tongue of any animal, or bring me the tongue of the human being. You put it, when you weigh it, it's so small. Yet you let it loose without controlling it. As our fourth Imam states, it is like a beast that if unleashed can be savage. And so we notice therefore that the tongue of the human being is such a vital instrument that it needs to be purified and it cannot be let loose. Therefore, we also find that Amir al-Mu'mineen states, I am surprised and amazed when I look at the human being. that he speaks through a piece of meat, and he sees through a piece of fat, and he hears through some bones. When you look at the human being, we hear through those three bones which balance our body, and we speak through this piece of meat, and we see through a piece of fat. And that you find that the human being thinking he is so intricate, it is not the intricacy of the weight of his objects, it's how he uses these in determining the success in one's life. That's why Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi, when he used to give the khutbah of Salat al-Jum'ah, a famous incident occurred which shows us that sometimes the tongue can be used in a proper manner, and that sometimes the tongue can be used in a devastating manner. Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi, when he used to give the khutbah for Salat al-Jum'ah, look how ironic it is, who's giving the khutbah about enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. When he used to give the khutbah, he would go past the time of Salah. His khutbah would be extremely long, in the same way as Ziyad bin Abi, his khutbah would be extremely long. One day when his khutbah would be extremely long, one of the crowd suddenly rose and said, "For how much longer are you going to prevent us from praying our salah? Every week in your khutbah, you are extending the time to an extent we don't have time anymore for our salah." The people looked around and they were amazed. How could you stand up to Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi? Are you crazy? When he stood up and said this, Hajjaj looked at him and said, "How dare you stand up against me? Do you know who I am? No one stands up to the words that I say." The person left the mosque and he went to do his own affairs. When Hajjaj heard this, he said, "I have to find this person because I'm going to capture him and I'm going to execute him." Hajjaj went around, and when he found the person, he entered the house. The family of the person were there. They had already told him that, "Look, plead that you're insane. Say that I'm insane and that sometimes these fits happen to me." When Hajjaj came in, he saw the parents and he saw the person there. He said to him, "Were you the one who spoke out against me when I was giving my khutbah?" The person said, "Yes, I was." He said to him, "Do you feel guilt or no?" He said, "I do not feel any guilt whatsoever." His parents started shivering, thinking, "That's it, we're all executed tonight." And they said to him, "Say that you are insane." He said, "I will not say that I am insane. I have said nothing wrong whatsoever, because my duty with my tongue is to enjoin the good and to forbid the evil. This man extends his khutbah and prevents us from praying our salah, and I will never allow my tongue to remain silent while he gives the khutbah." Hajjaj looked at him and he said, "One thing I have to tell you is that you are a brave man. That I normally, when someone speaks out against me, I finish him. But because of your bravery, not only do I want to release you, I want to reward you a big sum of money. Because someone like you, when they use their tongue so effectively, has to be praised and has to be rewarded. And that's why we find that the tongue can either be used in a good manner or the tongue can be used in a bad manner. That when a person uses his tongue to speak out against evil and to come out and praise that is what is good, that is a good way of using your tongue. When a person is truthful, that is a good way of using your tongue. But then at the same time, the tongue can be used in the worst of ways. For example, lying is one of the worst ways in which the human tongue can be employed. That the ahadith tell us that there is a door which is the door of evil, and that the key to this door is lying. And the idea that the religion of Islam sends a curse upon the liars, and that the liars are viewed as being the worst of people. That's why there is a narration from Asma bint Umais. She narrates that on the day that Rasulullah got married to Aisha, on the night, or the day that they got married, she said, "We were alongside Aisha and we were dressing her up and we were getting her ready for her marriage." She said, "We went towards the house of Rasulullah. When we entered the house of Rasulullah," she says, "that Rasulullah was present, but there wasn't much food there. The only food that was there was a bowl of milk." She said that Rasulullah drank from this bowl of milk and then he gave it to Aisha. He said, "Aisha, drink from this bowl." She removed the bowl. She said, "I don't want to drink any of this milk." Asma ibn Umayyah said that I said to her, do not be arrogant in this situation. Drink, for this is from the mouth of Rasulullah. It was narrated that what was left of the milk, Rasulullah took it and he tried to offer it to some of his companions. But that what had happened was that his companions started saying, Ya Rasulullah, we are not thirsty. Ya Rasulullah, we are not hungry. Rasulullah said, no, please take. They said, no, we are not thirsty or hungry. Rasulullah said, do not associate lying with hunger. Why? Because you know sometimes when we are really hungry and people offer us food, we say, no, we're not hungry. Out of respect for the people, Rasulullah said, even this is counted as a lie and will be shown on the Day of Judgment. That when you are hungry, do not say, I am not hungry when someone gives you. Give and eat. Give or drink. The idea here is what? That lying was seen as a method in which the tongue is employed in the wrong way. Another method in which the tongue is employed in a wrong way is when a person acts as a clown. Sometimes you find some people acting as a clown within the palaces of the royals, and therefore they are using their tongue in the wrong way. For example, Mutawakkil used to have a clown who was of an effeminate nature, very effeminate in his ways. Mutawakkil used to have this clown who used to play around in his palaces. He used to employ this clown for one particular purpose, to ridicule Ali ibn Abi Talib. What he would do is that he would say to the clown, make yourself as if you have a big stomach and that you are bald, and then use your tongue to make fun of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And then they would all sit down between them and they would actually watch this clown use his tongue to ridicule Amir al-Mu'mineen. Muntasir, the son of Mutawakkil, one day came in and saw this clown using his tongue to ridicule Amir al-Mu'mineen. Muntasir came to his father, he said, father, we may not necessarily agree with Ali ibn Abi Talib, but there is one thing about Ali ibn Abi Talib, and that is that he was a man with a truthful tongue. You are now employing clowns to represent Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is not something which is acceptable. Mutawakkil said, Ali ibn Abi Talib and his line are our enemies and we will continue to ridicule them one by one. This led to his death and he was killed by his own son, because his own son was the one who used the Turks, because of his hatred for his father's anti-Ali ibn Abi Talib comments, he used the Turks to kill his father. And therefore you find that until today, certain people use their tongues to do what? To act as clowns. That's why our fourth Imam says, let your tongues, direct your tongues towards politeness, and accustom your tongues towards goodness, and make your tongues too noble to say words of obscenity. Therefore you find another of the areas in which the tongue can be used in the wrong way is by cursing. That sometimes within our own communities you find people find it normal to curse between themselves. That it's normal within their households or between their friends that they curse and they use abusive language. And that's why the religion of Islam came and said to the Muslims, the early Muslims, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدُعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهِ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. The early Muslims, when they used to use their tongue against the opposition, they would come and abuse the idols of the idol worshippers. The early Muslims, when they would see the idol worshippers pray towards their idols, the early Muslims were told, would come forward and do what? They would come forward and abuse the idols. Rasulullah came and said to them that abuse is not part of the religion of Islam. The idea here was that the word sab was employed. وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Meaning what? Meaning that when you come and abuse the idols of the idol worshippers, they will turn around and abuse your Lord and your Prophet. The religion of Islam wanted people to use their tongue effectively, not use their tongue in abusing each other. Whereas you find in many Muslim communities today that abuse is even found as being something normal. That sometimes when they joke with each other, they come out and abuse each other by joking, through jokes. And here you find that another of the worst usages of the tongue in the religion of Islam is arguing with each other. But Rasulullah states that a mu'min can never claim to have reached full faith if they are still arguing with each other. And you find many communities today where the tongue, rather than being employed in helping each other, in looking after each other's needs, we find that the tongue is employed in doing what? In arguing with each other, in trying to put each other down. Therefore, the tongue, as Ali ibn Abi Talib said, it weighs something very small, whereas it is something which is very important. And that's why when you come towards ghiba and namima, what is the difference between ghiba and namima? Ghiba is when you reveal the traits or the actions or the history of a certain personality which they wanted concealed. Whereas namima is when you take this action or this trait or this history and you add a bit of spice to it and you begin to spread it within the community. That's why when you examine the verse about ghiba, when you come to examine this verse, you find that the examination shows you how the verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained it to us in a very graphic manner. The verse is in verse 12 of Surah 49 of the Quran. What does the verse say? وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضَكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدَكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. The verse is very graphic. It says, do not backbite one another. Do you like to eat your dead brother's flesh? Look how graphic this verse is. That when you examine this verse, there are 7 points which come out of this one verse about the subject of ghibah. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compare ghibah like us eating our dead brother's flesh? Why? What has our dead brother's flesh got anything to do with us backbiting? When you look at the examination of this verse, the first thing that emerges is this, is that when you come towards ghibah, you find that our dead brother's flesh, this verse shows something graphic, and it shows what is known as a prophecy. Meaning what? Meaning you are told how you would act on the day of judgment in relation to the way you were with your brothers on this earth. What do we mean? We mean that this verse is known as the verse of transfiguring an action. Which means that your action of ghiba in this world is transfigured into you eating dead meat of your brother on the day of judgment. That's why Rasulullah, when he was on the night of Mi'raj, Rasulullah, he came past people who were eating dead flesh. And he said, Ya Allah, who are these people? He said, these are the people who used to backbite each other in dunya. That in akhirah, they were eating each other's dead bodies. And that you find that the first thing emerges is that it's very graphic. That when you think about it, you compare it with each other, it is something very detested. Number two, the thing that comes out of this verse is that in human history, to eat dead bodies is something which is very detested. Unless you've seen the film Hannibal or Hannibal Rising, where you feel that Hannibal eats the human being, you find that apart from this, human history has shown us that mankind normally finds it as something disgusting to eat a dead body. That's why when you look in Islamic history, you find very rare cases of people who have eaten dead bodies. Apart from one case which we have mentioned in the Battle of Uhud, that after the Battle of Badr, when Abu Sufyan returned home, his wife Hind was sitting in the house. When he returned home, she said to him, how have you done in the battlefield? He said, we have been defeated. She said, by whom? He said, we have been defeated by the army of Muhammad. She replied to him, how is my father and my brothers? He said that they were killed on the battlefield. She said, by whom? He replied, by Ali, the son of Abu Talib. She said, who is that? He said that that is one of the young men of Arabia who follows the path of Muhammad. She said, I want him dead for having killed my father and my brothers. He said, then we will employ someone to kill him. She said, I want you to find for me a man who when he throws a spear, he will catch the enemy. And so Abu Sufyan, when they would sit together, him and Hind, they would have certain shows which would be displayed in front of them. Amongst the shows that was displayed was the shows of those who would throw the spear. Suddenly, when she was sitting down thinking, who should I get to kill Ali ibn Abi Talib? She saw this black man who, when he threw a spear, could get it through the smallest of holes. So she called him. She said, come here. In the next battle, I want you to aim at the Prophet of God who they claim is their leader. So he replied back to her by saying that their Prophet is a man who I cannot get. Because there are too many men in the battlefield who act as bodyguards for him. That if I'm going to try and throw a spear, it will not reach him. So then she said to him, kill Ali, for he has killed my own brothers. Again the person replied that Ali ibn Abi Talib is like a wolf on the battlefield. And the idea was that Ali ibn Abi Talib was known for one thing. He would never wear a shield on his back. The only shield would be at the front. On his back he was confident that no one could even attack him. Then she said to him, kill Hamza, for he is a man who is of our enemies. When Wahshi killed Hamza, this lady, if you want to know how despicable her character was, she came in the middle of the battlefield and she began to chew the liver of Hamza. That this was seen as something detested. Normally a person would not eat the body of another human being. It is something very low. Yet she began to chew the liver, the blood which came around her mouth. But that only because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she was not able to digest it. And she began to vomit it all out. History has shown us that eating dead bodies is something detested. Likewise, Allah wanted to tell us that ghibah is as detestable as eating dead bodies. That in the same way you find it disgusting to eat the dead bodies, you should find it disgusting to do ghibah about your fellow brothers. Number three, why did Allah compare ghibah towards eating our dead brother's flesh? Because when our dead brother has died, he cannot defend himself. Likewise, when you do ghibah, the person who you are doing ghibah about cannot defend themselves. How many times in the community when someone has died, when you bring mention of them, the people say, don't say anything, he's dead now. We can't say anything anymore because he can't defend himself. Likewise, Allah compared ghibah towards the dead because the dead can't defend themselves. In the same way, when you do ghibah about someone, they cannot defend themselves. Number four, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared ghibah towards the eating of the dead. Why? Because when you eat a dead body, your body becomes full of a sickness. It becomes full of a disease. Likewise, those who perform ghibah become people whose souls are full of diseases. Notice that when you come to eat a dead body, all the acids and all the blood and all the poisonous gases that you eat of a dead body, they all start coming into your own body. Your body becomes physically very sick. You become a body full of diseases. Likewise, Allah said that when you do ghibah of a fellow brother, now it is not a body which is full of diseases, it is a soul which is full of diseases. Number five, Allah compared it towards eating your dead brother's body. Why? Because when a human eats a dead brother's body, they become the center of disease. Not only is their body full of disease, they actually become a center of disease. That people do not want to go near them. People don't want to sit around them because their body is full of disease. Likewise, a person who does ghibah, his soul becomes the center of diseases. That when people sit around him, suddenly people start being less attracted towards that person. Because whenever they sit next to him, they find that the only thing that comes out of him is the bad of the people, not the good of the people. Number six, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is a very important point, compared ghibah towards eating your dead brother's flesh. Why? Because there are certain times where you are allowed to eat a dead body and there are certain times where you are allowed to perform ghibah. Understand this point. that there are certain times in our life where we are allowed to eat a dead body. For example, if I am alone in a desert and there is nothing for me to eat whatsoever, and what I have is nothing, the only thing that I see is a dead body. Can I eat it? Yes, I can. Because this is in a life and death situation. Likewise, in the religion of Islam, although ghiba in most cases is not allowed, there are some cases where ghiba is even wajib. And I will come to those cases in a moment. Number 7, why does Allah compare ghiba towards the eating of a dead body? It's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show us something very important. That as time has gone on, eating a dead body has been seen as something very low. That many people in the human world today do not eat the dead bodies because their intellects have risen and risen into knowing that eating the dead body is something very low. Yet Allah wanted to show us that if you know how well your community has progressed, or you want to know how well your community has progressed, then look at the way they treat ghibah. If they treat ghiba as something normal, then they are the lowest of people. Because while the rest of humanity has noticed that eating a dead body is something very low, there are some people who have not noticed that doing ghiba is something very low. If you want to know how well a community is doing, let your barometer be eating the dead body. Because the whole world today believes that eating a dead body is something forbidden and something detested. Yet the Muslim world in comparison feels that ghibah is something normal. Therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these 7 suggestions within this one verse. And that's why when you came to the area of ghibah, you found that some of the ahadith of Ahlul Bayt about ghibah make a person shiver in their place and wonder about the ghibah that they've done. For example, our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam has a hadith where he states that ghibah is worse than adultery. Ghibah is worse than adultery. Why? He states, because I am willing to forgive a person who commits adultery, but I am never willing to forgive a person who commits ghibah. A person who commits ghibah has to be forgiven by the people he did ghibah on. Imagine this idea. Rasulullah said, my Lord said to me, I am willing to forgive adultery, but I will never forgive ghibah. Ghibah can only be forgiven by the people you have backbitten. Therefore you find in one instance Rasulullah states that the worst type of income is when a person earns his income with 1 dirham of interest. And he said, interest is worse than adultery. So then someone said to me, Ya Rasulullah, what's the worst type of interest? He said, the worst type of interest is when a person backbites his brother in faith. Therefore the first hadith was what? That ghibah is worse than adultery. Then the second hadith of Rasulullah, when he states, ghibah affects what? Ghibah affects the religion of a person faster than leprosy affects the body of the human being. Ghibah affects the religion of a person faster than leprosy affects the body of the human being. Because when you see leprosy, leprosy is one of those diseases that it takes a miracle to cure. That's why one of the miracles of Prophet Jesus is what? Is that he was able to cure the blind and the leper. In his time, the people could not believe that anyone would be able to cure a person with leprosy. Whereas Nabi Isa was able to cure the blind and he was able to cure the leper. Rasulullah said, ghiba affects a person's religion faster than leprosy affects the human body. Imagine that. Because when you begin to continuously speak bad things about people, you will begin to notice that your approach to life is very pessimistic. You always look down at others rather than praising people. That's why the third hadith Rasulullah has about ghibah is a beautiful one. He comes forward and he says that ghibah affects a person's religion. And ghibah does away with the good deeds of a person faster than fire does away with wood. Imagine. Ghibah does away with the good deeds of a person faster than fire does away with wood. bring some wood and then put fire on it and see how they become ash straight away. Yet look at ghiba, it does away with your good deeds faster than even fire does away with wood. Why? There is a hadith which tells us on the day of judgment when we come, a person comes with his good deeds and another person comes with his bad. All of a sudden, the person who had come with his good deeds sees that his good deeds have become bad. And the one who has come with his bad deeds sees that his bad deeds have become good. The one with the bad deeds asks, how comes my bad deeds have become good? The reply was, because of that person who done ghiba behind your back. Because that person has transferred all his good deeds towards you. That's why when sometimes people tell us people are doing ghiba about you, we say, alhamdulillah, their thawab is coming on my shoulders. That's when a person does ghiba, he is doing away with his good deeds quicker than fire does away with wood. And that's why when you come towards the analysis of ghiba, people do ghiba for different things. But we find, unfortunately, our communities are breaking because of backbiting. Sometimes a person does ghiba because they feel they are religiously superior to everyone else. You find some people, they will say, so and so Mawlana over there, he never does a good job. And I do not see why people go towards that person. There is a hadith of our Holy Prophet, he says that on the day of judgment, there is a person who will come, his name is Dhul Lisanain, the man of the two tongues. Who is this person? He heaps praise on you in front of you, and then behind your back he brings you down. The first type of ghibah is you do it because you feel religiously superior to others. So you begin to backbite people because you feel you are religiously higher. The second type of ghibah we do it is the ghibah which is done because you feel economically superior to others. That's what you begin to do, is that those who are lower than you, or even those who are the same level as you, you try and do ghibah over them because you feel economically, in some cases, jealous of them. The third type of ghibah which we do is ghibah of physical appearance. That sometimes, because we feel we are more beautiful than others, you find that we begin to put down others' physical appearance. One day Rasulullah, Aisha was next to him. Aisha used to call Salama shorty. In some hadith it says Safiya, wife of the Prophet. Aisha used to say to her, you're very short. They used to make fun of her. Rasulullah said to her that this ghiba you have done is greater than the waves of the ocean. That what you have just said here is not the words of the wife of Rasulullah. But sometimes you find in our communities that we backbite each other because we feel that our physical appearance is superior to everyone else. And you find people mocking others because they find that their physical appearance is of a lower status. That's why when you come to ghiba, ghiba has three different types. There is absolute ghiba, implied ghiba, and apparent ghiba. Understand these three and you will find that many communities are destroyed because of these three. Listen to them. Absolute ghiba is what? Absolute ghiba is defined when a person reveals the actions or the traits of a friend of theirs or a brother of theirs which they wanted concealed. That is known as absolute ghiba. Then there's a second type of ghiba. Which one? Implied ghiba. Do you know what implied ghiba is? Have you heard those people who say, I don't mean to say this as a ghiba, but that person is stupid. What did you say? I don't mean to say it as a ghiba, but he is stupid. Who told you Allah will accept? There are some people who try and put the word at the beginning, I don't mean to say it as a ghiba, thinking that that's justified, now he can continue insulting. Then there's another type of person when it comes to ghiba, he's the one who says, Ya Allah, do not make this a ghiba, but I hate that person. Who told you Allah accepted your dua? Yes, you've asked, Ya Allah, do not make it a ghiba. Doesn't mean it's been accepted. Ya Allah, don't make this a ghiba, but that person is very short. So just because you said, Ya Allah, don't make this ghiba, means Allah has not made it ghiba? Number three, in implied ghiba. Listen to the difference. There is absolute ghiba, but then there is implied ghiba. Number three is when you are talking to someone and that person, while he's speaking to you, you wink with your friend in the corner. implied ghiba, the person's talking seriously to you and you've just seen your friend and your friend's telling you, you're really speaking to someone like that? And you go, that is what implied ghiba. That sometimes some of us, we have ghiba even in jokes. When we wink, we are winking with our friend and we are, in other words, saying to him, I don't know what I'm doing talking to this guy as well, but let me just talk to him anyway. Implied ghiba does not have to be from the tongue. Can be a wink, can be an eyebrow, it can be a movement of a facial expression, but that still remains as ghiba. Number three is the third type of ghiba which Ahlul Bayt differ over, which is apparent ghiba. That is when you discuss the life of someone, even though everyone knows about it, you still go on discussing it. He knows about it, other people know about it already, it's in the open, but does that mean you should still discuss it? Ahlul Bayt differ. Some people within the hadith of Ahlul Bayt tell us that such types, if you are discussing to help the person, is no problem. But if you are discussing to make fun of the person, yes, even if everyone knows about it, you should not discuss it to try and bring the person down. That's why ghiba was defined as being what? When you mention the action of someone which they wanted concealed. But what is the difference then between ghiba and namima? Ghiba is when you reveal something which they wanted to be concealed. Namima is when you work vigilantly to make sure that that is spread amongst the community. Sometimes you may speak about someone's action behind their back, but then there is another group of people who not only speak about it, they put a bit of spice to it, and then they make sure that everyone in the community hears about it. And that's why you find namima is known as scandal, or the telling of tales, and that it is destroying many of our communities. It is causing people not to get married. It is causing people who are married to get divorced. It is causing people not to come towards the mosque. And this therefore is seen as one of the worst diseases within the religion of Islam. That's why you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it in the Quran when He states, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Wail means what? In the Quran, it's translated in the English language as being woe. But it is not woe. Wail is one of the deepest pits of hell. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Wailun likulli humazatil lumaza, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was saying, the deepest pit of hell is reserved for whom? Humazatil lumaza, those who backbite each other, but as well those who cause scandals between each other. And therefore you find when you discuss this area, one day Nabi Musa, when he was living with the children of Israel, he was living amongst them and there was a drought. There was no rain coming down whatsoever. Nabi Musa came and prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Ya Allah, we have been praying for rain. I have been praying for rain. Why is it that you send no rain to the children of Israel? There is a drought and no one is able to eat or drink. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, Musa, I will not send down rain, because there is one person in the children of Israel who always causes scandal for the people. You can read as much dua as you want, but while this person has not asked for forgiveness, I will not send down any rain. Nabi Musa came out to the children of Israel and he said to them that, O people, the reason there is no rain being sent down is that there is one of you in the community who is causing scandal between the people. Only one. Only one. In our communities today there are 20, 30, 40. Only one. And I am not going to send down rain. All of you have to pray for forgiveness, because Allah will not send down rain unless that person asks. He said, I don't know which one of you it is, but every single one of you has to ask for forgiveness. A few days later, it suddenly started raining. Nabi Musa went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Ya Allah, what happened? He said, Musa, the one person in your community who kept on causing scandals and fitna, he came and asked for forgiveness. That's the reason I sent down the rain. If he had not asked, I would not have allowed any rain to come on the children of Israel. That's why in the hadith we say, Al-fitnatu ashaddu min al-qatl. Fitna is worse than watch, is worse than murder. Why? Because when a person causes scandal in the community, it doesn't just affect one person, it affects a family, it affects a tribe, it affects a religion. That's why again we find within the hadith that there was once a master of the children of Israel. Take this story on board because the similar stories have affected our communities in the world today. One of the masters of the children of Israel wanted to find a slave. And so when he was looking for a slave, he eventually found one in the house of one of his neighbors. He came and he said to him, "Your slave, I'd like to buy it, but I'd like to ask you a few questions. Is it strong?" He said, "Yes." "Is it healthy?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Is there anything you warned me about with your slave?" He said, "No, there's only one thing. My slave causes scandals. He tells false tales. But other than that, he's a very good slave." So he looked at him and he said, "But does he cook properly?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Does he do all the housework?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Okay, then false tales is nothing going to be too big. As long as he can do everything else, I don't mind. If he tells false tales, it doesn't matter, I want to take him." So he bought him. Look how important it is that if you let loose a person who tells false tales, he can destroy your house. He brought him home. He said, "Come home. It's your first day in our house. You are welcome with everything. Me and my wife are like your parents. Feel free to ask us anything you need." The person said, "Thank you very much, master." First day he's in the house. The master is there. He's left the house. Who's left in the home? The wife. The first day, the wife comes towards the slave. She says to him, "I hope everything's all right." He said, "Alhamdulillah, everything's good." She said, "Can I help you with anything?" He said, "Maybe there's one thing I have to tell you about." She said, "Go ahead." He said, "I overheard your husband saying he wants to marry a second wife." And you know, that's one always causes friction. So she said, "What did you say?" He said, "Yes, I overheard him. He was saying that he wants to marry a second wife. He's found something a bit more beautiful." He said, I thought I shouldn't tell you, but then I saw you and you're a pure person. So I thought that you must be told." She replied to him, "You said he wants to marry a second one?" He said, "Yes." He said, "I advise you to do one thing. He's got lovely, long, beautiful hair. In the night, when you sleep tonight, cut his hair. And then no one will like him because his hair is the only thing which is appealing." She said, "Okay, I'll do that." Husband came back home later in the afternoon. When he entered the house, the slave saw him. Husband saw the slave. He said, "Slave, I hope everything has been good on your first day." He said, "Yes, everything's been good, but something's been bugging me." "So what is it?" He said, "I overheard your wife saying she wants to kill you tonight." Husband said, "What?" "Yes, she said she wants to kill you. She's not very happy with the way you've been behaving." He said, "We've got the best relationship. What do you mean?" He said, "No, I just overheard her. I thought I'd warn you. You're a pure man." In the time in the children of Israel, when you'd want to cut someone's hair, they wouldn't have scissors like we do today. They'd have knives. You'd cut the hair with a knife. So now you imagine what happens that night in the bedroom. The wife comes to sleep. Husband comes to sleep. Tension. The wife wants to take the knife out thinking, "I want to cut his hair." And he wants to take his knife out thinking, "I want to kill her." Because he's worried that she's going to kill him. Now you imagine the scene. That as soon as she takes out the knife to cut his hair, he thinks she's taking out the knife to do what? To kill him. He kills her. He kills her. And the children of Israel, this is a story within the hadith. When her family find out, they become angry, they come and kill him. When his family finds out, they become so angry that they go and kill the whole tribe of the wife's family. All because of what? One person. He said one scandal, it caused the destruction of a whole community. That's why Rasulullah tells the wives of the Prophet, the Quran tells them, "Ya Nisa al Nabi, man yati min kunna bifahishatin mubayyinatin yudha'af laha al-'adab dha'fayn." The Quran tells the wives of the Prophet, "O wives of the Prophet, whoever comes out with you with an open indecency, Allah will punish you double the punishment. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was warning the wives of the Prophet that if one of you comes out one day, one of you, and causes a scandal within the community, Allah will punish her double the punishment. Is this hadith or Quran? Quran, Surah 33 verse 30. That Allah says to the wives of the Prophet, irrespective of the fact that you are the wives of Rasulullah, if you cause a fitna within the community, we'll punish you double the punishment. That's why when the battle of Jamal happened, it was all because of the fitna of one person who coincided with two others to cause a fitna against Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali ibn Abi Talib was Khalifa for 4.5 years. And in 4.5 years, they never let him rest once. Because day after day, they would cause a scandal about his life. Day after day. That's why one day a person came to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said to him, when Abu Bakr and Umar were Khulafa, there were no wars whatsoever. Whereas when you have become Khalifa, there is war after war after war. He said, because in their time, they dealt with people like me. Whereas in my time, I deal with people like you. The idea was that in my time, I am dealing with people, all they do is cause scandal. The Battle of Jamal. You want to know how great Amir al-Mu'mineen was. That before the battle started, he knew the scandal was all against him. And that they had come to kill him. And that they had said he was the cause of Uthman's death. Do you know, before the battle started, he called, Talha came out, Imam came out. Imam came towards Talha crying. He said to him, O Abu Muhammad, do you not remember the days me and you grew up with each other? Do you not remember the days we fought alongside each other to defend the religion of Islam? Now you come towards me in the battle of Jamal to kill me. O Abu Muhammad, ask Allah for forgiveness. What we are doing is that we are causing a fitna that is going to kill thousands of Muslims. Talha said, you are the cause of Uthman's death and you are protecting the killers. We will kill you and your partners. Then Zubair came out, Imam came out. Zubair, Imam looked at him, Imam said, Zubair, do you not remember when one day you said that you will always be with me? And Rasulullah told you, oh Zubair, one day you will leave Ali ibn Abi Talib and you will not be on his side. And you said, Ya Rasulullah, I will never leave Ali ibn Abi Talib. And now you stand in front of me on the Battle of Jamal and you want to leave me? Zubair, when he saw this, he couldn't take it anymore, he ran away. Then when Aisha came out, the mother of the believers, when she came out, Ali ibn Abi Talib said to Aisha, the killers of Uthman, we will find them and we will bring justice to justice. But we should not bring thousands of Muslims to come and kill each other because of a scandal, which is not true. She said, you are defending the killers of Uthman and they are in your army. Either you give them to us or we kill you and whoever's in your army. Look at the people he dealt with. Would you show akhlaq back to people like this? Would you? Yet when she was sitting on her camel, on her carriage, on the camel, Amir al-Mu'mineen was there. He knew that the only way this scandal would finish would be if she comes off the camel. Because while that camel is still up, she will still be victorious. So do you know what Amir al-Mu'mineen did? He said to Malik al-Ashtar, he said, Malik, she is sitting on the camel in her carriage. Go and cut the feet of the camel. Then he said to another of his companions, he said that when she falls, pick her up, because I cannot take seeing her fall on the ground. Pick her up straight away. Malik al-Ashtar went and he cut the feet of the camel. Her carriage, when the camel was falling, her carriage fell. She fell out. The other companion picked her up. She said, remove your hands from the body of the wife of Rasulullah. How dare you touch me when you are not mahram to me? Do you know what the person replied? He said, I am Muhammad, the son of Abu Bakr, your brother who has picked you up. Ali ibn Abi Talib knew that the only man in his army who was mahram to her was her brother. So he said, I will not disrespect her by sending her someone who cannot touch her. I'll send her her brother so that when she falls, her brother is the one who picks her up. Therefore you found that scandals caused the death of over 30,000 Muslims because of the fitna against Amir al-Mu'mineen. That's why in our final area, the question arises, when does ghiba become wajib? Some people come and say, how could something that is haram be wajib? That if ghiba is haram, how can it one day be wajib? You see, in usul, in the study of fiqh, there is a principle known as bab al-tazah. What does this mean? This principle, understand it because it's very fine. This principle is the principle of the order of importance. What does this mean? This means that sometimes in our life we face situations where there is something where we have to judge the order of importance. For example, imagine now someone is drowning in a river and I can hear them calling out to me, please come and save me, please come and save me. I have to cross a piece of land that has been usurped, it's ghasbi. Can I normally, in circumstances, can I normally walk across land which is ghasbi or no? No, I can't. Normally, can I? No, it's haram. But here, there is someone who is drowning. And therefore, is it wajib on me to save the life of a human being if they are drowning? Yes. Now I have a situation, I have to walk across land which is ghasbi, which is haram, to get to something which is what? To save the life of a human being, which is wajib. Here the scholars say there is something known as the order of importance. That in this situation, you have to save the life of the human being. Normally, if it was just you walking across a piece of land that is ghasbi, you can't. But because there is the order of importance principle here, you have to cross that land to save the human being. How does this apply to ghiba? Ghiba sometimes becomes allowed or becomes wajib because of the order of importance of a situation. How? One of the areas where ghiba is allowed is in marriage. Why? Normally ghiba is haram. But if I don't do ghiba about a person who has proposed for a girl, who they have asked me about his character, and I know that he is a physically abusive person, and I know that he has a reputation for hitting women, and they come and ask me about his character, I can't say I don't know nothing about him. No. Ghiba in this situation is allowed. Why? Because the order of importance dictates that in the long run, if you had not said that he was a physically abusive person, and later on he goes on to abuse that girl, it was in your hands and you could have changed the situation. Therefore, the first area where ghiba is allowed is in cases of marriage. That's when someone comes to ask you for a character reference, and you are 100% certain about that person's character, you are allowed to do ghiba about them if you want to stop the proposal from continuing. Number one. Number two, the second area where ghiba is allowed is against a zalim. The second area where ghiba is allowed is against a zalim. Why? Because normally ghiba you can't do against anyone. But against a zalim it is wajib in the order of importance. Why? Because if you done ghiba on a zalim and made people rise against him, you could possibly be saving the lives of thousands upon the millions of people in the future. That's why you find the Imams of Ahlul Bayt would stress that you are allowed to do ghiba behind a zalim because you have to rise against injustice. That's why Bahlul has a beautiful story where whenever he would see dhulm being done, whether it is done against a human being, against an Imam of Ahlul Bayt, in a hadith or in words, he would always speak out. One day a person came, you know there is a hadith which states that if the faith of Ali ibn Abi Talib was put on one side of the scale and the faith of the whole of humanity was put on the other, Ali ibn Abi Talib's faith would always rise. One day this hadith was changed. How? I'm not going to mention the name from Mimbar. But if the faith of so and so was on one side of the scale and the faith of all humanity was on the other side of the scale, his faith, mashallah, would rise above all humanity. Irrespective of the fact that he called the Prophet delirious, irrespective of all these things, no. His faith is higher. Bahlul saw this as being dhulm. Because he could not accept that Ali ibn Abi Talib's iman was being chalked out so that the oppressors in history became the people of iman. So when they came to Bahlul, when he heard this hadith, they said, Bahlul, did you hear the hadith that person so-and-so's faith, if it was put on one side of the scales and everyone else's faith was put on the other, this person's faith would rise? He said, I don't agree with the hadith. They said to him, why? He said, there must have been a problem with the scales. So here the idea was what? The idea in the school of Ahlul Bayt was that when you see dhulm, ghiba is allowed against the zalim. In order to make sure that whether it is with your tongue, or with your heart, or with your weapon, to stop dhulm is allowed in the religion of Islam, even if it means bringing down from the person. For the aim of the religion of Islam is to remove dhulm from all areas of the community. That's why, as a conclusion, if someone does ghibah about me in my community, should I then stop coming to the mosque or no? Because there are some people who come and say that I don't want to come back to the mosque. Because whenever I come, people do ghibah about me, or people do fitna, or people do namima, or people make false accusations. I'm sick and tired of the mosque, I don't want to come back. Is this the attitude we should have or no? The answer is given in a story of Nabi Musa when he said the same thing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi Musa came to Allah. He said, Ya Allah, everyone backbites me. And everyone makes false accusations about me. And everyone puts me down and attacks me. Ya Allah, will you not stop those people? Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied back to his prophet. His prophet was saying to him, Ya Allah, people backbite me. They say evil things about me. They falsely accuse me. Ya Allah, will you not stop them? Do you know what Allah replied? Oh Musa, I haven't even given myself that honor. I am your Lord and they backbite me. And they say evil things about me. And they say I do not even exist. And they say that I am evil and that I have no mercy. Have I ever stopped any of them? So why should I stop them from saying about you when I have not even stopped them talking about me and I am their creator? Therefore, even if our community is plagued with ghiba, it shouldn't be an excuse for us to run away. Rather, it should be a reason for us to enjoin the good and forbid the evil, and to try and purify ourselves and then purify the whole community. Because one important aspect at the end is to understand that the listener to ghiba is worse sometimes than the one who is doing ghiba themselves. That it's one thing saying ghibah is bad, but when you enjoy listening to it, then you are part of the problem, not part of the solution. And that's why Rasulullah said that if a person listens to ghibah and he defends his brother in faith when the ghibah is happening, Allah removes 1,000 sins of that person. But if a person listens to ghibah and he continues with the ghibah without defending his brother, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adds 70 sins towards that person. Therefore we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove ghibah from our communities and to remove false accusations and scandals from our communities. To allow us to be on the path of Muhammad and Al Muhammad. To allow us to speak the truth and to use our tongue in the best ways. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us on the path of Ahlul Bayt. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the Surah Al-Fatiha, but before it, the loudest salawat.